Hello everyone, I'm Tim from Tim Does Level Design, and welcome to Lesson 2 of my beginner course in video game level design. At the end of Lesson 1, I've given you the homework exercise of playing through the provided demo levels, so I hope you've been able to do that. If not, I've also uploaded an addendum video to the first lesson of a full playthrough for you to use as a reference. Those demo levels aren't necessarily well balanced, paced, or all that great examples of the best level design, but function for you to explore the game's abilities, enemies, and other elements in a short period of time. In this lesson, we'll be creating our first very own test level. In video game development, we often refer to test levels as gyms. These levels are never meant to end up as part of the actual game, but are used by the development team during prototyping and production to test various elements of the game as they're being created and tweaked in a controlled environment. So with our project open in Unreal Engine, let's open up the content drawer again by pressing the content drawer in the bottom left of the screen. Hovering over the content drawer button with our mouse, we can see the shortcut displayed to open and close it, which is Ctrl plus spacebar. This is a handy shortcut to remember, as this is an action you'll repeat a lot, and shortcuts make your workflow a lot faster. If you're going to be doing a lot of stuff in your content drawer, you could also press the Dock and Layout button, which will make this window a more permanent fixture of your layout and prevents it from disappearing again. Whether you wish to keep opening and closing the content drawer, or sacrifice a little bit of screen space to keep it open for convenience sake, is completely up to you. To undock it, you can always press the little X button next to your content browser tab. If you accidentally make any mistakes and mess up your layout, you can navigate to the Window tab in the top bar. And under Load Layout, select Default Editor Layout to reset the layout. And don't worry, it has happened to me so many times over the years in various engines and editors that I accidentally press some kind of button combination, not knowing what exactly, but it totally messes something up and requires a layout reset or a full editor restart. Anyhow, let's open up the content drawer and from the content folder, navigate to the maps folder. Here, I've created a handy map template that you can duplicate and modify to create your own. So let's right-click on this template and select Duplicate. We can now rename this, so let's call it map underscore gym underscore 3C. If you've clicked away from the level file after duplicating it, you can right-click on it and select Rename. 3Cs is a term that we often use in game design and refers to character, controls, and camera. These are the key elements that dictate how the player, through controlling a character, perceives and interacts with the game world that we're creating. Think of the camera perspective, like first-person games such as Firewatch, third-person perspective games such as Fortnite, or overhead perspective games like Hades, which uses an isometric perspective. Top-down or side-scrolling perspective games are technically, of course, third-person perspectives as well, though we don't often refer to them that way. Key to 3Cs is also, what can the character do? Like running, jumping, climbing, and how does this feel? Whether you're an indie developer or work for a big AAA studio, a 3C gym is often one of the first, if not the first level that's created in a project, to help testing and tweaking the fundamentals of what will become your game. By the way, the little star icon on your map thumbnail indicates that it hasn't been saved yet. To make sure we don't lose any progress in event of a crash or whatnot, and yeah, your engine crashing sadly isn't uncommon in game development. Let's click File in the top left and press Save All from the drop-down menu. We can also press the shortcut Ctrl plus Shift plus S to save everything. So double-click on the created 3C gym level to open it up, or press Enter with the asset selected. As mentioned in the previous lessons, the biggest window open is called the viewport and functions as our window into our level. When we hold down the right mouse button in our viewport and move the mouse around, we move around the camera that allows us to see into the viewport. While still holding down the right mouse button, we can use the W and S keys to move the camera forwards and backwards, the A and D keys to pan left and right, and the Q and E keys to move the camera up and down. Please practice flying around the viewport for a while until you start getting familiar with these controls. While holding down the right mouse button, you can also scroll up and down with your mouse wheel to increase and decrease the camera speed with which you move around the viewport. Notice that in the top right of the viewport, the number next to the camera icon changes when you do that. You can manually input a number here to set your camera speed and scaler number. You'll have noticed that in the provided template, there are already a couple of blocks and various other elements present. In Unreal Engine, we call them actors, meaning any element that can be placed into a level. Let's investigate them. If I click on one of the blocks in a viewport, an outline appears to indicate which object is selected, as well as the translate gizmo that has a blue, green, and red arrow. If the translate arrow doesn't appear for you, make sure that in the top right of your viewport, instead of select objects, you have the second icon, select and translate objects selected. If we click and drag on either of those arrows, we move the selected actor on the corresponding axis. You can press Ctrl plus Z to undo the previous action. Movement is often referred to as translation. In between the translate arrows, we can see these little squares. Clicking and dragging here moves, or translates, the actor on the two corresponding axes at the same time. Whereas clicking and dragging the white sphere in the middle moves the object across all three axes at the same time. Whenever we have one of our actors selected, we can find more information about it in the Details panel, which is in the bottom right of your editor by default. We can ignore most of the stuff in the Details panel for now, but let's briefly focus on the Transform section, which displays, for example, the location of the actor. When we move the actor, the values of the X, Y, and Z axes in the Details panel get updated according to the position of the actor. We can also change these values by inputting a number directly in the Details panel. When we then press Enter, it updates the position of the actor according to the new value. Or we can click, hold, and drag along the input fields to move the actor along one axis at a time. When I move the block, you may have noticed that it moves in fixed increments. This is because I have grid snapping enabled. In the top right of your viewport, make sure to click on this little grid icon until it's blue, which means grid snapping is enabled, and click on the value next to it to select the value 50 from the dropdown, which sets the increment of movement to fixed intervals of 50 Unreal units at the same time. An Unreal unit is by default set up to represent 1 centimeter. When you now move your actors around, you should see them snapping to those fixed values. To make sure things line up nicely, let's keep our location values in the Details panel to numbers nicely rounded off to intervals of 50 as well. Looking at the other actors in our level, the controller icon with the white flag over here is our player's start actor and defines where our player will be spawned in the level when we play. Let's move it a bit off to the left. If it's clipping through the ground or other geometry, it should indicate bad size, as a warning that this may cause problems when spawning our player character. So let's make sure it's not intersecting with any of our geometry, and when we're happy with the place, let's press the green play button again, or Alt P to test our level, and we can see that our character begins exactly where we put our player start actor. I'll press Escape to stop the simulation. Now, let's select one of our floor blocks again, and explore some other things we can do with our level geometry. Before moving it, let's press Ctrl plus C and then Ctrl plus V. When we now move it, we can see we've copied the block and then pasted it in the same location of the copied actor. You can also press Ctrl plus D to duplicate an actor, which will immediately create a duplicate and offset it a little bit. Let's create a few more duplicates and extend our floor to the left. Let's press Ctrl plus Shift plus S again to save our progress, and press Alt plus P to quickly test our changes. Now, let's select one of the blocks to the far left again and duplicate it. I'll move it back into position and a bit upward so we have a clear view of it. Again, in the top right toolbar of our viewport, next to our Select and our Translate tool, we find two more icons. To the right of our Translate tool, we can select the Rotate tool. Instead of the arrows from the Translate tool, the Rotate tool gizmo provides us with three arches that we can select and drag to rotate the object along the corresponding axis. I'll quickly hit Ctrl Z again to undo. Just like the other grid snapping, we can also turn on snapping to a rotation grid, which allows us to rotate on fixed degree intervals. Let's set it to 5 degrees and use it to rotate our block 90 degrees on the y-axis. If I go back to the Translate tool, duplicate this and move it up, I've created a nice wall to test our wall slide and wall jump against. As it's really easy and quick to just press play, always test your content continuously as you make changes. Let's select one of the blocks in our wall, copy, paste, and drag it out. In our viewport toolbar in the top right of the screen, next to Select, Translate, and Rotate, we can select the fourth transformation icon, which is used to scale actors, meaning changing their size. Just like with the translation gizmo, we can modify the actor across one specific axis, two axes at once, or all three, holding and dragging the central gizmo cube. And like the other transformation tools, for scaling, we can also set snapping options to only scale to fixed intervals. And we can see in our details panel that the scale values get updated accordingly. Now we've discussed copying, pasting, and duplicating actors, and using the transformation tools to modify them, we can easily copy and paste objects, and then use hotkeys Q to select, W to translate, E to rotate, and R to scale, and quickly populate our levels with some more geometry for our player to interact with. Practice with these hotkeys a bit, and over time, it will become easier and easier, and you can quickly modify blockouts without even needing to think about it. And remember to always test your changes. As our gym level is meant for testing our 3Cs, let's see if we can find out how high an obstacle needs to be to block our player from jumping over it. Let's create a bit of space in our gym to test this, and move over our player start actor so we don't need to walk all the way over each time we want to test something. Now let's go into our content browser again, and this time navigate to the folder called LD Blockout Meshes. Find the static mesh actor called SM_floor_1x1 and drag it from the content browser into your viewport. Because this asset scale is 1x1, when we scale it, we won't need to do any annoying calculations to figure out how big it really is. Like, when we take a 4x1 block and scale it 1.75 times in length, this means the true length is 4 times 1.75, which is 7. Over time, this can become very confusing. With our 1x1 block, if we scale it by any amount, this is multiplied by 1, and therefore its true value. Let's scale up the height to 1.75 and press play to test. Without using wall slide or double jump, we can definitely still jump on top of it. When we scale it to 2.0, we can just about jump on top of it. I'll up the scale to 2.3 and notice that we can no longer make the jump. Changing the values a couple of times to zero in on the actual value, I noticed that with value 2.21, I can still make the jump, but 2.22 is our cutoff point where I can no longer jump on top. Now, for a player, it's impossible to judge during gameplay whether a block is 2.19 units high or 2.25 units high. So, when using values too close to the cutoff point, a player will never know whether they can jump on top of something or not. Meaning, they will continuously need to try and likely will get frustrated not being able to make jumps that appear to be reachable. So we probably want to settle on some margins for a maximum height for a reachable jump, possibly around 2 units, and a minimum height for what we'll call a blocker, possibly around 2.5 units, which should allow players to more intuitively read how they can interact with the environment. So now that we've gone through the basics, it's time for this lesson's homework assignment. Before starting the next lesson, I'd like you to set up and make use of your new 3C gym to test a couple of crucial metrics that you will want to keep in mind moving forward when you start designing your own playable levels. So set up and testing your 3C gym and find acceptable margins for the maximum basic jump height that we just explored, the maximum jump plus double jump height, the maximum jump distance, the maximum jump plus double jump distance, the maximum step-up height, meaning if we encounter a ledge, how high of a ledge can we still walk onto without jumping, and which margins here do we find acceptable, as some height differences might look a bit awkward, and the maximum height jump plus double jump plus teleport, as using teleport can keep upwards momentum and resets the double jump, allowing players to reach higher points than you might expect. So please set up some test cases in your gym and write out your findings so you can use them as reference for yourself moving forward in the course. If you find any value in this course, please do like and subscribe and hit that notification bell to get notified when the next video goes live. Thank you very much for watching and see you in the next video.